In this section, we will discuss about the VPC peer gateway feature. So this feature was mainly designed for the NAS devices and for the F5 devices. So if you talk about the NAS devices, they do not follow the normal default behavior of doing the ARP request or the ARP resolution for the default gateway MAC addresses. So let's say when the NAS devices boots up, it is listening to the network flows, and based upon that, it assumes that some MAC it finds out the MAC address of the SVI of the VLAN 20 of the primary device. Let's say for the SVI of VLAN 20, the primary device is having the MAC address of 0A, and at secondary device we have the MAC address for 0B. So now NAS device is assuming 0A as the gateway MAC. Okay, so now if there is any frame or if there is any communication which is happening into the different network, so for the default gateway MAC, it is going to use 0A. Now, if let's say this NAS server is communicating to this particular PC here, when it sends the frame to this device, let's say this is switch one, and based upon the hash, if we consider that the switch one sends traffic to the secondary device, so in the destination, the secondary device is going to find out the MAC address 0A, right? So now 0A secondary device is learning over the peer link, right? So this so the secondary device is going to send that particular frame over the peer link to primary device. And now because of the loop avoidance mechanism, your traffic will be blackholed. Primary device cannot send this traffic to the VPC member port because of the loop avoidance mechanism, which says that any traffic that we receive on a VPC member port, and when that particular packet travels over the peer link, it is not allowed to go to another VPC, or it is not allowed to egress to any VPC member port. So that is why the VPC peer gateway feature was designed. When we enable the VPC peer gateway feature, then both your primary and secondary device, they also start listening for the SVI MAC also. So now secondary devices will also listen for 0A. Okay. And the primary device will listen for 0B, which is the SVI MAC for the secondary device. And they will also, what was the gateway MAC? It was 0D, for example. So they will also listen for the virtual MAC. By default, they already listen for the virtual MAC, right? Whenever we enable the HSRP, and also by default, they are the active device for the virtual MAC. But when we enable the peer gateway feature, they will also start doing the active forwarding for the SVI MAC also. So now in this case, when the NAS server replies, and if the secondary device receives that particular frame with the MAC address 0A, which is the MAC address of the SVI of the primary device, it is not going to send it over the peer link, but it is going to send that particular frame directly to the downstream device. So this is the benefit of using the VPC peer gateway feature. And the same logic also applies in the case of F5 devices. So when we use the F5 devices, so just let me clean it up a bit. Just give me one moment. So let's assume this situation. So our F5 devices are also doing some kind of tracking for the source MAC address just to make the symmetrical path. Okay, so we use this. Let's say F5 receives any traffic, so it will keep track of the source MAC address which it received on its interface, so that while replying or for the return traffic, the traffic must follow the same path just to avoid any asymmetrical routing. So in this case also, let's assume this situation that this 1.1.1.1, it is going to communicate with the with any of the server behind the F5. We have multiple servers behind this F5 device, but we have the particular IP that is 10.1.1.100. That is the IPO on the F5 device. So this is our F5 device. Okay. So when the traffic comes to the, let's say traffic comes to the primary device. Okay. So before sending this particular frame to the F5, the primary device is going to rewrite this packet, and it is going to put its own MAC address, right? Let's say this 0A is its own MAC address of the SVI, 0B is the SVI MAC of the secondary device, and 0C, let's say it's the virtual MAC of the SVI. So before sending that particular packet to the F5, so the primary device is going to mention its own MAC address. Okay, so now F5 is going to note it down that the frame that I received or the packet that I received on this particular port channel, I received it from a MAC 0A. So when F5 is going to reply or going to send the return traffic to this particular the gateway in a normal circumstance, right? So the it must put the 0C MAC address into the frame. But because it is doing the source MAC address checking, so in the return traffic, it will put the MAC address that it received into the frame. So it received a 0A in the frame. So instead of 0C, which is the virtual MAC of the SVI, it is going to put 0A. And let's assume that based upon the hash, the traffic went to the secondary device. And now because secondary device is learning 0A via the peer link from the primary device, so it is going to send this particular frame to the primary device. Okay, so now we have two situation. Let's say this is a normal port channel. So in that case, primary device is going to send this to the destination device. So the drawback in this case is that our VPC peer link is going to be utilized. And in our in a good design, it is recommended that we do not send any normal traffic or any data traffic to our VPC peer link, right? That is the soul of our network. So, and in the worst case scenario, let's say if this particular port channel is into VPC, then your traffic will be blackholed, right? Because any traffic which enters on a VPC member port and that travels over the peer link is not allowed to exit to any other VPC member port. So these are the two situations, or you can say the particularly the VPC peer gateway feature is designed for the NAS devices which do not follow the normal standard process of the ARP and all. Okay, and also for the F5 devices which keep a track of source MAC address in a particular design. So in that case, VPC peer gateway feature will be helpful. So it will play the same roles in case of F5 as well, that both the devices will start listening for the SVI MAC also. Okay. So if we go to our switches, just give me one moment. So right now I am on the N7K1, right? So if I check show IP interface brief, so we do have two SVIs here, VLAN 10 and VLAN 20. So if I check show interface VLAN 10, right now we are not using the VPC peer gateway feature. Now you can see that the SVI MAC for VLAN 10 on N7K1 is 5034000A. So if I go to N7K2, and I check this particular MAC address, if I do a show MAC address table, pipe include 5034, right? So this is the MAC address, 5034000A, right? 5034000A and 0007. So now you can see 7K2, it is learning this particular MAC address via peer link. Same for the VLAN to interface SVI, for the SVI VLAN 20, right? For VLAN 20 SVI as well, it is learning it via the peer link, right? I do show interface VLAN 20. So for the SVI MAC, both the devices, they are learning the MAC addresses over the peer link. So if any traffic comes for the SVI MAC, then they don't have any option, right? So they just need to send the traffic over the peer link. And in that case, we do have two situations. Either our VPC peer link will be overutilized or will come into picture, or The second case will be that if you are using the VPC on the member port, then our traffic can be blackholed. So we do not need to run any extra command. We just have one simple command that we can run. If we go to VPC domain, we just need to do peer gateway. That's it. And when we are enabling the peer gateway feature, then it does not impact anything. Okay, as far as your existing data traffic is concerned. So you can enable this feature anytime. There is no problem in that. So we'll go to VPC domain and we'll say peer gateway. Now let's see what's the effect of this. If I go to N7K1 and now if I check show interface VLAN 10, it's 503.400.0800.7. Now let's go back to N7K2 and run the same command. Now you can see here, we have a gateway bit in front of these MAC addresses, right? So the when we do have the gateway bit in front of the MAC addresses, now you can, earlier you can see there was only star. Now we have the gateway bit. It means that now the N7K2 will also listen or is also active for this particular MAC address. If it receives any traffic with this MAC address, it is going to process it by itself. It is not going to send it to the peer device. And same is the case for the MAC address of the SVI of N7K2. So the N7K2 SVI MAC is 503.400.0900. So if I go to N7K1, if I do a show MAC address table, type include 5034. Now you can see for VLAN 10 and 20 SVI MAC, it is also it also start listening. You can see here the gateway bit. Sorry, not here. This is the HSRP MAC. So you can see here. So this is the SVI MAC of N7K2. Now we can see a gateway bit here. So now if there is any traffic that comes for these particular MAC addresses, so N7K1 is going to handle it by itself. So this is the benefit of VPC peer gateway. Okay, so let's go back to our slide and see if we miss anything. So VPC peer gateway, so peer devices will listen for the SVI MAC of other device. So that we already discussed, right? That once we enable the peer gateway feature, the peer devices will start listening for the SVI MAC also, right? Apart from the virtual MAC. Second point is it keeps the forwarding of traffic local to the VPC peer device and avoids the use of peer link, right? So when the VPC peer device start listening for the SVI MAC of other device, then there is no need to send the traffic over the peer link. So that is why in this case, our peer link will not be used. Third point, you can see here that we can activate it anytime, that we already discussed. So the last point is it was designed for the devices like NAS that do not follow the standard R process to retrieve the MAC address of gateway, or the F5 devices which uses the source MAC address for the return traffic to keep the path symmetrical, that we already discussed, right? Now our next topic is the VPC peer gateway exclude VLAN feature. Okay, so this particular feature was introduced in the NXOS 5.1.3 to address a specific topology with the VPC peer link. Okay, so this particular feature, first of all, we need to know that this will work only in one design, wherein our peer link is configured with the F1 module ports. Okay, and your other ports are in the M1 module. Okay. The second point, you can see if the peer link is on M1 port and other ports on F1, then it is not going to be work. Okay, so the only condition for this particular case for the VPC peer gateway exclude VLAN is that your VPC peer link must be of F1 line card and your other ports must be of M1 line card. Any other combination is not going to work. The last bullet point also, you can see that for all the same type of line cards, it is not supported. It is supported only when the peer link is on the F1 card and other port on the M1 card. Okay. So let's see this example. So this is one of your L3 device, which is having neighborship with your primary device and as well as with your secondary device. Okay. And also you have, let's consider a situation that they are running some protocol, routing protocol, and they are exchanging the routes. Now, just in case, let's say this link goes down on your secondary device. Now your secondary device is not going to receive the routes from the L3 device, right? For this situation, what we have done is that we are running one more SVI here. Let's say interface, let's say VLAN 30, interface VLAN 30 here on both side. Okay, here also we are running interface VLAN, let's say 30. Okay. For the backup routing, and let's say we are running OSPF between interface VLAN 30. So just in case this link goes down, so via peer link now switched to or the secondary device, it can receive those particular routes. Okay, so you can consider this as a backup routed path. Just in case the WAN link goes down on the device, then it can go over the peer link to reach to the destination. Because let's say this particular PC, it is going to communicate to this L3 device, and based upon the hash, if traffic comes to the secondary device, then if it is not having the routes, then there will be a problem, right? So now let's say this particular PC sends the traffic to secondary device. Now secondary device will do a routing checkup, right? It is now, because the WAN link is down for the secondary device and it is receiving the routes from the primary device. So it is going to check its routing table, and in the routing table, the next hop will be the SVI IP, right? And the SVI IP will be of the primary device because it is receiving the routes from the primary device only, right? And now, because we are running the peer gateway feature, the MAC address will be flagged with the gateway bit, right? And because of that, your traffic will be software switched from your secondary device to your primary device. There will be a kind of software tunnel between these two devices, and then your traffic will be switched. And the problem with this design is that because of that software switch of your traffic, we may experience a lot of packet drops and delays on the data. So to avoid this situation, what we can do is we need to enable the VPC peer gateway exclude VLAN feature. So if we exclude the VLAN interface VLAN 30 from the peer gateway feature, then this gateway flag will be removed, and now your devices will start sending the traffic for that particular MAC address using the hardware. Okay, they are not going to switch to your traffic using the software tunnels and all. So your traffic will be hardware switched. So in that case, there will be no traffic disruption. Okay. And the second problem that we can come into is that, let's say this is your layer 3 device and you're forming the, let's say, OSPF neighborship. Okay. Between your primary device and your secondary device. Let's clean it a bit. So you're forming a OSPF neighborship. And because you are running the peer gateway feature, so your let's say the primary device SVI MAC is 0A, SMAC is 0B. Now, because we are running the peer gateway feature, it is also listening for 0B. So now let's say your primary device sends the hello packet to your L3 device and it is requesting for some LSA or some network, right? And because your L3 device, when sending the traffic, because of its port channel, so, and your secondary device is also listening for the MAC address 0B, it sends that particular information to 0B. Okay, so now your primary device is not having that particular LSA or that particular network. Let's say that network was 1.1.1.1. So now let's say when this PC wants to communicate to 1.1.1 and based upon the hash, if it sends the traffic to primary device, now because primary device is not having that particular information, it is going to drop the packet. Okay. So this is the another situation that we can come into if you are using DVPC peer gateway feature. So it is recommended that if you are using your SVIs to form some kind of neighborship on your WAN links, so you need to exclude those particular SVIs from the peer gateway feature, because see, this peer gateway feature that is useful for your LAN devices only. If you are doing some kind of routing over the WAN, then this feature can create some problem into your data traffic. So VPC peer gateway exclude VLAN feature that we studied, right? So the first bullet point that we discussed, that if the WAN link on one of the peer goes down, it can use the backup path over the peer link for the routed traffic, right? But because of the peer link feature, we have the gateway bit set for the next hop IP MAC addresses, right? So because the SVI that we use for the routed path, so for that also the gateway bit is set, and when the device is going to check the issue IP routing table, and when the frame will be sent for to put the MAC address on the frame, then that will be software switched, right? Because you are using the because you do have the gateway bit set for the SVIs, right? So now your traffic will be software switched, and you will experience heavy packet loss and delay due to the control plane policies and the hardware rate limiters. So this is the simple command that we can use to exclude that particular VLAN. So if we want to avoid this kind of situation, either we need to use a dedicated layer 3 link between your peer devices for the backup routed path. And if you just want to use the SVIs, so just make sure that you exclude that from the peer gateway command, just to avoid the software switching and to avoid the heavy packet drops and unexpected behavior on the data plane. So just this is a simple command that you will use. After the peer gateway, you just need to say exclude VLAN and the VLAN number. That's it. So as soon as you give this command, your traffic will be hardware switched. Okay. Also, so now you can see here, the solution is that to make our traffic hardware switched, we can exclude the SVI, okay? Also, the second bullet point you can see here that we also discussed, that we can also face some forwarding issues if we are using the SVI as a routing protocol between your WAN devices, okay? So on that also, you can see some unexpected behavior on the data traffic. So it is recommended that if you are running your routing protocols over your WAN links, so with the peer gateway feature, you should exclude those particular SVIs from the peer gateway feature. So this was all about the VPC peer gateway. In our next section, we will discuss about the failure scenarios. So we'll go into details into the various failure scenarios of the VPC peer link and peer keep live link. Thanks for watching.